Hello everyone. In this video, I'm going to show you a worked out example on how to use the formula that we derive for designing the bending moment capacity of concrete beams based on Australian standard 3600 2018. So now let's imagine that the client has approached us and asked us to design a 5 meter simply supported beam for a corridor which is supporting a 300 millimeters thicker slab, and due to some restrictions that has actually been set by the client or the architect, the depth of the concrete beam should not be bigger than 300 millimeters due to overhead clearance for the car park under the corridor. All right, the first thing that we need to do is to calculate all the loads, live load, dead load, and self-weight of the concrete beam. And when we define all those loads, then we need to use the load combination formula, which has been given here and is taken from AS1170.1. And the formula is 1.5G plus 1.25Q. Q is your live load and G is your dead load and your self-weight of the concrete beam. Now, in order to calculate the beam self-weight, first we must define the concrete density. And in this case, we considered the density as 2,400 kilograms per meter cube. And this number is taken from Australian Standard 3600 2018 clause 3.1.3. And as you can see, the density is set as 2,400 kilograms per meter cube. I go back to the example again. So now you have the density, you multiply that by the depth, which is 300 millimeters. You convert that to meters and you multiply that by the breadth of your concrete beam, which is going to be 0.2. And you multiply that by 10 in order to convert that to Newton. And you divide all of that by 1,000. And you get 1.44 kilonewton per meter. And just make sure that all the units at the ends must be the same. So in line, in terms of line load, so kilonewton per meter. So now the self-weight of the actual concrete slab is considered as the dead load for the concrete beam. So in this case, we're designing this concrete beam right in the middle, and the spacing between these concrete beams are 1.5 meters. So now the tributary, you have to define the tributary width of that concrete beam right in the middle, and the tributary width would be in this case would be half of the entire width of the corridor, so 1.5 meters, because it's supporting half of this slab up to here and is supporting half of this slab on this side. And now you multiply the density by 1.5 meters and you multiply that by 0.3. That would be the depth of your concrete slab, and you multiply that again by 10 to convert that to Newton, and you divide that by 1,000 and you get 10.8 kilonewton per meter. Again, you see that the units are the same. Now, what about the live load? So in order to calculate the load combination, we have the dead load, the self-weight, and now we have to find out the live load. So the live load is, again, in most standards, you get the live loads in terms of kilopascal, because they give you normally the surface load. And in this situation, we've been given 4 kilopascal, and I'll show you where I got the value. So the value is taken from Australian standard again, AS1170.1, and in table 3.1 you see on the C3 areas without obstacles for moving people, and you've got corridors and the load is defined as 4 kilopascals. So you go back up again, and now you have the dead load, the self-weight, and you multiply that 1.5, and again, because the load, the live load, is uniformly distributed on the surface, again you have to multiply that 1.5, which would be the tributary width of that concrete beam, in order to convert the surface load to a line load. So now you've got load combination of 25.86 kilonewton per meter. All right, now that we have the load combination, we use this formula. The ms star is equal to WLS squared divided by 8, and that's for simply supported beam bending moment. So we have 25.86. You plug in the number here, 2.586 times 5 meters squared, that is the length of the beam, and you divide that by 8 and you get 80.81 kilonewton meter. So now we have this formula that we derived in the previous videos, and to basically use that, first we need to find out what KU we need to have. All right, when you selecting your KU value, you have to be mindful of two facts. One, if the KU that you're selecting is in line with the criteria which has been set by the standard, and second is if you get the right bending moment capacity with that KU value. So for this example, I'm going to use KU of 0.36 just to show you what maximum allowable area for steel you can get, and from there you can reduce the area of steel in order to reduce the KU value in order to make it to bring it into a safe range between 0.2 and 0.36. All right, now that you have set your KU value as 0.36, which is the maximum allowable KU, then you have to use this formula here to find out your maximum allowable area of steel. And to do that, you need to find out alpha sub 2 and gamma based on Australian standard AS3600 clause 8.1.3.1, and you can define gamma based on clause 8.1.3.2. So for this example, we're going to use 32 MPa concrete, and therefore your alpha sub 2 and your gamma, they're going to be 0.802 and 0.89 respectively. Now that we have alpha sub 2 and gamma, we need to consider the cover. We assume that the cover is 20 millimeters, and the area of the rebars that we're going to use for reinforced concrete beam is going to be N20. N20 means the diameter of your rebars, they are 20 millimeters. I draw a quick figure here just to show you how to calculate the D, which is this D. The D is from the outermost compression fiber, which is here, all the way to the centroid of your rebars. And if you have N20 here and your cover is 20 millimeters, then D would be easy to calculate. So that's your big D, which is 300 millimeters, and this D is going to be equal to 300 minus half the diameter of your rebar. Just rewrite that again, sorry. 300 minus 20 divided by 2 minus the cover, the 20 millimeters, and D is going to be 270 millimeters. Now you have everything that you need to have, so you rearrange your formula here to find the P max. And just one thing to note here, The 500 is the yield strength of your rebars. So they normally call it N500. So that's going to be 500 megapascals in yield strength. Now you have your P of the maximum allowable. So the P is, as I've shown here, the P is the area of steel divided by the breadth of your concrete, which is going to be this B, and the D, which I've shown here. So you have your area of steel divided by B and D, and you have the P maximum allowable, and from there you can find the maximum allowable area for steel, which is going to be 1020.21 millimeters squared. Now that we have the area of steel, the maximum allowable area of steel, then we can use this formula down here, which we derived in the previous video. And from there, we can find out our ultimate bending moment capacity. And we have all these variables here. We have F prime C as 32 MPa. We have these 270 millimeters, this one. We have B, the breadth of your concrete, which is 200 millimeters. Alpha sub 2, 0.802, and we have, I mean, we don't need gamma in this formula, and FSY is, we're using N of 500, so the yield strength of our rebars is going to be, 500 MPa, and the area of the steel, as I shown here, it is 1020, and the same, you've got this, these variables again here. You plug in all the values and you get the ultimate bending moment capacity as 112 times 10 to the power of 6 Newton millimeters. Just bear in mind, we used all these values here. They generally, in their strengths, are in MPa and in millimeters, so that way you're going to get your final result in Newton millimeters. So you have to multiply that by 10 to the power of minus 6, which is going to give you 112.4 kilonewton meters, and that's your ultimate bending moment capacity. But to define the design bending moment capacity, you have to multiply that by a reduction factor. And the reduction factor is shown here. So it's 1.24 minus 13 times this Ku, as I explained before. This is going to be our, Ku, which is 0.36. And we get 0.85. So to show you where I got this equation from, I actually copied and pasted that into my Word document. So there are two tables here. Table 2.2.2. The top one is from AS3600 2009, and the bottom one is from the same standard, but a 2018 version of that. So as you can see, we have to use this formula here, and that is because we are not putting any tension or compression on our rebars, because this is just a conventionally reinforced concrete bars. We're not it's not a post tension or pretension concrete, and we are using class N reinforcement, and that's why we have to use this formula here. And if you put Ku as 0.36, you're going to get 0.85. however, if you reduce the Ku, which that was our intention, then your this value is going to go to, let's say, 0.87, and if that's the case, then you still have to use 0.85. just bear in mind, go back up again. Now you have 8.5, that's a reduction factor, you multiply it by the ultimate bending moment capacity, and you get the design bending moment capacity of 95.54 kilonewton meters. Now that we have our design bending moment capacity based on the maximum allowable area of steel, which was also defined based on the maximum allowable Ku, we can use this area of steel, but the problem is we can't go exactly this amount, so it has to be a number smaller than this, so because that was our maximum allowable area for steel. So if, since we decided to use N20, if you use three N20s, then our maximum area for steel would be 942. So the area for steel basically is, I've copied it from a source on the internet, so you can see, as you can see, N10, N12 and N16, all of these sizes, they have their own a specific area, and for N20 we are going to use 314 millimeters squared. So I go back up to the example again, so you have, if you use three N20s, you're going to get 942 millimeters, which is smaller than the maximum allowable area of steel, which we actually, this is the area of steel that we needed. But if you put four rebars, that is going to be 1,256 millimeters squared, and that is going to be bigger than our maximum allowable, and we should avoid that. Also, a side note is, with that area of steel, because it's lower than our maximum allowable area for steel, then our Ku is going to be smaller than 0.36, which was our intention, and that is very good. So again, we have to recalculate the ultimate bending moment capacity based on the changed area of steel, which was originally we calculated with 1020, and now we are going to use with 942 millimeters squared. We recalculate that bending moment capacity, and with that you have to redo your PU, which is again the area of steel divided by BD, and you need to redo also your Ku value, which is going to give you 0.335. And again, the reduction factor, as I explained before in those two tables below, these two tables, so we are using this table and this formula here. So you redo your Ku value and you recalculate your reduction factor, and it's going to give you 0.87. but again, as I explained here, we're not supposed to go anything above 0.85, so we keep it at 0.85, even though we have a smaller Ku, and your reduction factor is going to be multiplied by the ultimate bending moment capacity, which you design here, which you calculated here. You multiply the two together and you get 89.76 kilonewton meters, and you have to compare your design bending moment capacity with your actual design bending moment. And the design bending moment, the 80.81 kilonewton meters, calculated it, we calculated it here based on this formula, M star is equal WL squared divided by 8, and that gives you 80.81 kilonewton meters. And when the design bending moment capacity is greater than or equal to this number, the design bending moment, then your design is basically good to go. I hope this has been helpful, and if you have any questions or comments, please let me know, and I wish you best of luck. Thank you.